Welcome to my office/garage/smoking chambers, Julian.
Yes, it
is. We had a pretty damn good Saturday so far. Yes, sledge session this morning.
It was pretty good.
Which I'll say, so in my mind, you didn't maybe notice yet, but in my mind, I've yielded to you for this experiment for April.
And so you said?
Yeah. So, and actually, the last time we were hanging out, you mentioned one of the most interesting things I've thought about strength was that one of the things I've been struggling with the last probably 2 years is like the will to train just has not been there. The fire to train really hasn't been there. And it's actually been a little bit frustrated because I didn't quite know what the source that was, because it's not from like will. I've been wanting to train and get back into flow. I mean, several attempts at the program for myself and get things lined back up, but there was something sort of in the way. And revisiting the idea of the key log and what now I'm really aggressively getting at, which is untying the sort of the root of my problem, which is like this deep issue kind of rooted in the middle of my back, wherever my lats attach.
Yeah. And it's a problem a lot of lifters face is training hard. It's something it's who you are. And I mean, since early age, you always wanted to train hard and everything. And I see a lot of lifters when they, you know, pass their early 20s, they get to that spot where the desire goes away. And it's very rough.
Sad,
because
man.
Suddenly you feel you lost your identity as a person. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, it hasn't really gone away. It's just the pain is getting to you. People have the wrong idea about pain. So pain, there's no such thing as a pain receptor. Pain is only intensity. We have intensity receptors, not pain receptors. Mm-hmm. That was an idea from Descartes about like 400 something years ago, that we had pain receptors that signal to the brain the problem. That's not true, though. We have intensity receptors. And so we get to a certain level where the brain has to decide whether the intensity means danger or not. That's mm-hmm. why cold and heat feel the
will
same
the
at a certain
hold
level.
Together under stress.
Or I'm about to chop my hand off. Is the fire going to burn my hand off or stuff like that? And so now you have two ways to go on there. Either you can do an exercise which will result in tremendous amount of pain, but no structural damage, like your joints will not suffer and everything. If you go down that road, that means every time you go there, you wake up the next day, you are not hurt. You realize you can go further into that pain cave and further and further and further. And that will feed the fire. But then you can go the other way, which is even like a lightweight can hurt you, hurt your knee. Now there's damage to the body. And that eventually is when the brain decides, okay, this is dangerous for me. There can be structural damage from that exercise. And this is a battle you will lose over time 100% of the time. You will, your if it's not just, oh, this hurts, it's not enough to make you back off, the brain will find other ways to kill you. It will take your energy away. It will take the fire away. It will take the desire away. And it will crush your soul. You will go in the darkest place ever, but you will lose.
Lifts,
yes,
the squats.
You will lose.
The passion wasn't there, and I feel like now I got lost. And now was the time to sort of stop that path.
Exactly. You're just going down the wrong way. It doesn't mean you haven't lost the fire. The fire comes back. I see that even with young athletes. Yeah. Like they feel like the fire is gone. It's not gone. You just done it incorrectly. That's all. There is a way out of this. All we have to do is to teach you again to go through that pain, but without damage. And that's something you see like in many sports, like in CrossFit, where that idea that you're supposed to be hurting to progress. No, you're supposed to be in
pain. No
pain,
no gain persists in CrossFit.
And
today,
I agree with that, but that's the problem is what kind of pain are we talking about? Are you supposed to go through pain to get better? Yes. But what kind? The one that is just in, the intensity that leads to progress is one thing. The intensity that leads to injury is another.
Yeah.
There is a difference between the two. And most people get that confused. They think like to get the good kind of intensity, you have to go through injuries. On the contrary, so you can teach yourself to feel in a way less pain. Every time you don't get hurt, you go through that pain, the body is like, okay, we can go further. So you teach yourself to feel less pain. But the other way is you teach yourself to feel more pain. Every time you have damage, the next time you go back to that exercise, the brain will send more signals of pain. So you will go one way or another. If you go toward feeling more pain, eventually you will lose that battle.
I feel that way during squats now sometimes. Like I'll warm up as well as I can. I go just the act of extending under load, I'll get these like warning signs
down
in front of my knees. And now I've got no hope of getting a heavy set of five.
And
then
everything is heavier. And are you gonna do that what? Every week? Within
8 weeks?
Yeah, exactly. So but you break and then your fire goes away. So now you take the pre-workout or you go to our drugs or you take the painkillers not to feel it.
Rock and roll lifestyle.
And you lose that battle every single time.
Yeah, and then for me also it was like the challenges of just frequent travel too, and having two small kids. Before you know it, like
it your takes
body's,
everything. Yep.
The shape and the way it's functioning is just way off. So now I've had two proper sessions with you.
Yep.
The first was not really that great. Second session out this week, even just the second dose at a certain repeated frequency, 1 week later, I did like twice as good on the pulls. And I felt really happy to be doing it, not nervous to be doing it. I'm like, oh God, like, are my lats going to turn on? Like, things were starting to untie.
And again, we're in a lot of pain, right? It was not an easy session.
No, like, no,
by the
not
time
easy.
You finished the harness, it was, and but yet your body right now is fine. You feel the fire is back. You'd be ready to train
Popeye
again
forearms,
right away.
Popeye forearms from the fat rope to the hand over hand pulls. And then the greatest part, we talked about this earlier in the kitchen. The best part about how you structure your training is, like we talked about before, the genius thing is like starting with a simple thing that activates and promotes good motion, and then sequencing and stacking movements, where by the end, you only need one good rep with the heavy sled pull, because before that, you did the thing that blasts the front of your quads. And heavy sled pull
bashes
your ass.
I'll take the quads away, and then the harness will destroy your
And then before
your ass
that,
will be on
you,
fire.
You take away the thoracic spine, the lats, and you get everything going. So by the end of it, you're totally fucking smoked.
Yeah, so no, there is a way to do this. It just has to be the smart way. You don't have to. You can get smashed. Like the harness will make you flop on the ground and everything. Yeah. You just don't have to get hurt. That's the difference. And you have to be 19 to think like getting hurt doesn't matter. You have to be that stupid.
Well,
which I was, by the way, like everybody else. But
the pain-free stages of training where you can do anything. You just throw yourself against the wall a bunch and you heal no matter what and you can recover. You get up next day.
And you think that's the way to go because they all tell you, if you don't go there, you're not tough enough, whatever the reasons are. Now that I'm older, looking back, I was like, I don't know what I was thinking. I have no idea, but surely it wasn't working. You know what I mean? Like, and
waste of effort.
Whatever it was, but man, that was so, looking back, it was so stupid. I get way more results, and actually, I can train harder now in a way, because I can go in the pain cave. I couldn't even approach when I was 19, 20, not even close, but now I can push so hard, because I know I will not pay a price of structural damage for it. So I can push so far. There is no limit to how far I can push. It's just eventually, I just mentally can't take the pain anymore, but I could go further. Yeah. That's every session. I feel I can go a little bit further and a little bit further because I don't pay that price of waking up the next day and my knee just won't bend, my ankle hurts. So there is a difference there.
There's some clear qualities about sleds. You can push them very, very hard and immediately feel like this is way, way intense. This is no step down from barbells. This is really fucking hard. This is every bit strength training as everything else is.
Yeah, because at first it's weird. Like, you don't hurt the next day. You go like, did I do
anything?
Then you notice it doesn't.
You're like,
did I do
suffer?
Anything? Yeah, that's weird. I must have not done enough.
Like, the prowler. So, the prowler will zap your life force, give you the prowler flu, totally make you want to die.
And then you wake up the next day. Yeah,
and you're
like, huh. So I must not be doing enough. Then that's the problem, too, is because they don't hurt the next day, people are like, that can't be enough.
Yeah.
That cannot be enough. It cannot be that simple. No, it is. Because it's low eccentric, no weight bearing, so you don't stress the joints that way. Now, my training is based on how much am I going to damage the soft tissue of my athletes. Because, again, you will not win this.
Yeah.
You won't. And so, but that way you can, like, imagine a zone of 6 months where you could push the pain barrier to a max and not pay the price the next day for it. Like, so mentally you would pay the price, but physically you're still in one piece. Imagine if you could do this
for six months. That's what you would hope to do. What was the ideal condition for the barbell? Take enough drugs where you could do that, where you could keep training every session and keep progressing.
Pushing like crazy.
That's what's almost like people don't think it's possible, but you can do that with a sled.
Because you can always push harder. On the product, you can always take two more steps.
Yeah.
And again, you can pull a rope, I can push, I can drag, you can use the harness and everything. And you will push your muscles to limits that you can't touch with a barbell.
Yeah.
Because there is no eccentric, because there is not that, you know, the soft tissue damage and everything. Imagine 6 months of pushing like you did this morning. If you could do every day, even the different things, imagine after 6 months how strong your mind would be.
Well, I'm committed
doing
just to
that.
Doing just the month straight of just two sessions a week, just knowing just what that will do.
Yeah. And you'll see the change right away. Even your body will feel the change because suddenly your body won't be afraid to push. There won't be that stick every time you push.
Yeah.
It will be just carrot. Instead of every single time you push hard enough, you know you're going to get hit with that fucked up stick that will destroy you, and here comes the ibuprofen for 3 days.
Yeah, the other great quality I find with those methods, the sled in particular, is that with a barbell, sometimes you're just forcing the progress. Like, I'm just going to put another 5 pounds and fuck it, we'll see what happens. And with a sled, you're kind of discovering the progress.
Yeah.
Like, I come back and naturally, I just know I can go a little more.
Yeah, those
it's just there for me to go for.
And again, we all talk about functional strength, but a sandbag, a sled, That's really functional movements. Yeah, there is no barbell in nature.
I was going to ask you
by
that.
Definition, yeah.
For most people, you've mentioned a few now, but let's go ahead and say, for most people, what they need is a whole lot more of in order to be properly strong. People get a lot of barbells now very quickly, specialize really quickly. They really jump into programs that are very narrow channeled, too specific, too fast. What they need to spend way more time on. What are the exercises that give you the most in return? They don't take very much.
I love the sandbags. So for me, the sandbag squat, like I did squat 550, and I feel honestly like, so I've done 500 for reps, and I feel like squatting a 260 sandbag for 5-6 reps has a greater effect on me now than squatting 500 for 5-6 reps. No. I kid you not. And so the sandbag squats is one of my favorite squatting. The sandbag carry does about every muscle I can think of. And then coming from grappling, when I carry a sandbag, I'm like, this is what grappling feels like.
Yeah.
Let's talk about functional. So the sandbag squat, the sandbag carry, the sandbag clean and jerk I love because it's so awkward to put overhead. It's not like a bar where you can drive with the legs and everything. Like, it's a sandbag, it's huge. Your core is going to engage way more than any other exercise known to man. And then after that, it's all my sled. So it's pulling the rope on the sled. It's the pushing the sled sprints. The drags, one arm drags, two arm drags, the harness. You honestly, enough sandbags and a sled, I can work anything.
We apply the Einstein idea that you've reduced the training to the simplest possible principles, but not any further.
But not simplistic. Simple, not simplistic. Mm-hmm. And that was something Einstein always tried to explain to people, is like, you try to go to the simplest base possible, not the simplistic based in people. And it's a little bit what you see with a barbell, like, because we all got used to it and everything. And so the squat is the exercise. I'm like, no, because there is no bar in nature. I'm sorry, if we go functional and everything, which one do you think is going to give you more if you wrestle a bear? A big sandbag or a barbell? I'll go with a sandbag every time.
Yeah.
I know that from wrestling and, you know, and jiu-jitsu and all that. The sandbag is the greatest thing ever.
Yeah.
And the carries will make you, if you think you're, your core is strong, Try walking with a 300-pound sandbag weighing on your stomach and tell me how that feels.
Yeah, I learned that, like I told you. I discovered the joy and the utility and practicality of the Husafelt stone.
Yes.
Like, I played football at the University of Memphis, I trained with a guy. We were so meat-headed, it was crazy. We were driving by in his truck, and all we did was watch strongman shit. When we were practicing football, we just watched repeats. We drove by a golf course. They were busting up. They had these huge chunks of concrete, and one of the big piles had a bunch of triangular-shaped chunks. We found one that was about fucking 300 pounds.
I would have stole one. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And I got it. And like, of course, we would cut ourselves up.
Yes.
Giggled, and this we drove this thing back to the campus and put it where we train. And the strength coach is like, "What in the shit are you doing?" But we've lugged this thing around, and one of the things you discover is, you're strong, you can carry a thing, you can fight. Can you do all those things at the same time? Can you breathe during that?
Yes.
Can you keep your composure? Can you not freak the fuck out while this is laying on your chest? Like, it's not the same as lifting it. No. It's not the same as deadlifts.
And you know, it was a test of manhood back then. Like, you had three different stones, and to go on fishing trips, I think it was in Iceland, to go on fishing trips, you have to be able to take a certain stone of a certain weight and size and carry it a certain distance. If you could not do that, you are not going on fishing trips.
You're not useful. Fuck off.
Yeah, you're not a man yet. When you come back stronger, you can come back.
Yeah, and then there's an acute pressure of, you cannot drop this. Like,
yeah,
it's not like, oh man, you just totally blew the workout. No, you're not in the clique of men in this village. You're fucking toast. We can't trust you.
Yes.
If you can't carry the stone when it doesn't count for life and death, what are you going to do when it does fucking count for life and death? Like, different kind of pressures for now. You know why, the strongman, Magnus for Madison and all those guys, were the culture of strength, the sport of it was so easy compared to the culture of it. Like, the real need to be practically strong and really what the farmer's handles meant in real life, carrying heavy shit for a long time with cold hands. That's what's so beautiful about strongman. It's really linked in some elements of strength.
And all the Viking, those were all like, who's the strongest man of the village? Those were the events.
Yeah.
Close to farming and then test of manhood. Can you take this, carry it over there and everything? Yeah, so that's... But those were like real life application movements.
Yeah.
I think we got, I love the barbell work, but we got maybe a little bit too excited with this.
Yeah.
You got, and again, the damage on the soft tissue with a barbell is tremendous. Like, when you squat a lot, man, like, you know, we all know this from the knees and then the hip and everything. Like, there are ways to squat where you can disengage the glutes completely, things like that.
Now, you get around.
That's the problem with the leverage of the bar, is you can go around certain things. You can cut corners. With a sandbag, you can't.
Yeah.
It will hit you everywhere. The bar allows you to find certain leverage that are more beneficial to you, which is great, but not if you do just that. Because now you're cutting corners, you are doing certain things you shouldn't, and before you know it, you're imbalanced, and now you're in the wrong kind of pain. You're in the one that causes damage, and now you're screwed.
I feel like I've always really liked that idea of looking at barbell training, the dose, like a medication dose.
Yes, it's great.
Minimal dose to get what you're after.
Exactly.
If you go too much, it's because you can now. Man, you pay such a steep fucking price.
Balance. Balance everything. That's how the body, we have, it's called homeostasis. It's the body seeks to obtain and maintain balance. It's a very important concept. And everybody is always stuck on the something called stress response homeostasis, which is favorable response to stress, which is programming out there. It's how can we stress the body enough to elicit a response? Okay, but the body is also based on homeostasis, which we have that from, like, you know, the temperature, too hot, too cold, you die, acidity, you know, pH level in the body, all that stuff. So everybody is based on balance. So it's great to have the homeostasis side. But if you don't have the homeostasis side, you will break. You cannot make progress without the two. So that's where training is managing those two concepts that are almost opposite and finding how to make those two work together. This is something you see in theoretical physics all the time. Is, you know, they talk like, how do you make gravity and quantum mechanics work? This is how you get a good definition of the world. Is the day we make those two work, we'll have a clear idea of how the universe works, truly. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing with training. Is, can you have those two principles that are almost opposite working together? If you can do that, you have something. And that's what I call critical mass, is that when I can make those two work together. And now we make progress. You know what I mean? That's where it is.
Like, we were brainstorming last time you were over here about, like, you can get away with so much for so long until the last little bit where, like, for me, it was, I had such a goal, I wanted to squat 1,000 pounds, and where did I ping out at? 975. You know, like, that, the one principle, the jam in my stream cost me that last little bit. And then, I guess one thing that is so refreshing about your style of training now is, like, I get a sense of, like, there's, the more I do it, there's possibility. There's, when I think of, like, the removal of key log, that idea of, like, we're not, like, quickly loading as much as we can, get as much done as we can as quick as possible, which is pretty much the paradigm of all training thought. Like, how can you just get as much done as possible, get as much done now?
Before we break.
Versus, how can I set you up now to be as high-powered in a year, 2 years from now? Like, removing that one thing now that will cause you immense suffering 10 years from now when you don't quite get to the finish line.
It seems like... Like, my idea is that the body's evolution got us where we are. Nature gave us a body that it's perfect the way it is. It took us, you know, 300,000 years to get here. It's perfect the way it is. We just fuck it up along the way. We are the one messing it up. But so all we have to do is go back to a natural state and things will take care of themselves. We are very good at adapting. If you're just in that natural state, we can adapt, and 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, keep getting stronger, keep getting moving forward. So I, in a way, I have a very optimistic look at how the body works.
If you get your head out of your way.
Yeah, exactly. And things like that. And whereas the other part of the problem is more like the body is not bad, but there's something intrinsically wrong with it. So let's pound it until it breaks. Because, you know, it's not that strong, so we will break. I'm looking at it the other way. No, it is great. It can take it. You stop fucking it up on the way. Just let it grow with it, and you will take the weight. Like, it's almost like you don't trust even your own goals. It's like, no, you don't have to pile up so fast to get to 1,000 pounds. You will get it. Just relax, let your body grow with it, and you will go past it.
Yeah.
Stop. So I think it's almost the way people look at the body that is wrong. They just want that quick stuff, like, before the body breaks. It won't.
Yeah.
If you do it correctly, it doesn't have to be that way.
Now I've kind of rallied around the idea of saying, if you want to be strong, the best way of doing that, paradox in life, like, don't try to be strong, don't start reaching for strength, don't try to start going for numbers. Instead, put all your effort on the conditions, optimal conditions from which amazing strength can emerge. Because, like, when you start working better, all of a sudden the sled moves faster, They weren't trying to add more weight and pull harder on the sled. You were just able to do more with the sled.
Pull the sled. And I mean, just get into that zone. Like, imagine again, like a zone where you could push your body to the limit every time without breaking the next day. Like, so it's the idea of critical mass. We're talking about Barbell Shrugged. Imagine if I could just stay in that zone for 6 months. Imagine the results you would get. The problem is the second you're in that zone and the training feels great and everything is moving well, what is the first thing we do? We fuck it up. Pedal to the metal, and then within
more
2 weeks, you're ready.
More is better. More is better. Going,
and so, how long do we all stay in that zone where the training is great, everything feels right? Did you ever stay into that zone more than 2 weeks? Because I haven't.
No,
as a kid, never. Well, I would stay 2 weeks and then back to grinding myself to oblivion.
If on the grand scale you've trained for 100 hours, let's say, in your career.
Yeah, how many of those hours were? Yeah,
of optimal and in the groove and really productive, almost none. Maybe one out of the 100
okay.
I could call
it
great.
Now, imagine,
most was just me flailing and throwing myself against the wall, trying desperately, experimenting, trial and error, mostly error. You know.
Imagine if I could keep you in that zone for 6 months. Imagine what you would
do.
Imagine what it would do to your mind, to your head, of being able to train at that level of comfort, of, you know, loving the training and being so motivated and doing so well. Imagine if I could keep your body and your mind in there for 6 months. Imagine how far you would take that and how it would change who you are as a person, how you look at training. Imagine how it would change you if you could stay in that zone for 6 months instead of 1 week.
But the only real magic, the only thing you're really looking at is to stack the effects of training, right? If you just string
together. Just string them together. That's
decent,
all.
Easy sessions.
Stay in the zone. Just get in that zone, stay there. Push, don't break.
Yeah.
Just push. And that's, again, but have that trust in I have that fundamental trust in the human body. I think if I can just stay in that zone, great things will happen.
Yeah.
You don't have to force it. That's the thing. That's almost like cultural bias of, no, the body has to be forced into things. It has to be broken into obeying. No, it doesn't. No, I've never seen the body like that. And that's where I think they make so many mistakes.
All of our training theory must be based in the weird, like, Quaker religious idea.
I think
the
there's
body
a
is
tremendous
bad, sex,
cultural bias.
Sex is bad. Treat your body with pain.
Pleasure is bad.
Pleasure is bad.
Yeah. If it feels great,
gym,
it can't be that good.
No.
It can't be that good. I think there's a tremendous cultural bias, the Protestant bias of the bodies that intrinsically things that you cannot trust.
Yeah.
You should not trust the body. Whereas I look at it exactly the opposite. The body is great. You're fucking it up. So,
I found that doing parkour, man. When I tried to do parkour moves, and my brain totally
got in the way. Yeah.
When they explain, like, what you're trying to do is not get over this thing. Get over this thing with the mindset that you got to land in order to get over the next thing good. So I was trying to string things together. And I quit thinking. All of a sudden, my body just went over shit.
Like,
you forget your body.
Yeah.
300,000 years to form a human, billions of years to get up to that point. It fucking knows. There's nothing you're gonna throw wild card at your own physiology. It just can't happen.
Mm-hmm. And so we mess it up. That's where it kills me. That idea that you have to force the body into a certain thing. No, it's there.
Yeah.
Don't worry. Stay in that zone. You don't have to push it every single time.
Yeah.
So that's really what my the whole training is about. I just try to balance athletes. I know by nature, hormesis is easy. Stressing the body for response, that's the easy part. That's what all coaches do. That's programming.
Yeah.
I'm more trying to balance the body so it can respond to that programming. You know what I mean? But without that part, you just cannot move forward. You will get and remember, the second you're hurt, your brain will set you back. I mean, I'm just trying to move forward.
see, like you're now doing a good job of rebuilding people. One, I've seen you rebuild athletes with a hell of a lot of potential. Now you're getting great results.
Yeah.
I've also seen you work with, like, you got a lot of great footage, like, on your Instagram account, like guys coming in crippled, bad injuries.
Not in good shape.
Returning to function. So it seems like you're not necessarily, like, you are a strength coach. You really come to restore people. Like,
yeah, and a lot of it, honestly, is their mental approach. Like, the guy you saw that was in the walker and everything, yeah, he was an NFL player.
Riddled with...
The guy was 52, and he could barely walk in a walker. I mean, he was in a walker, not even walking, but just barely moving and everything. Painkillers, you name it, and everything. And the biggest problem is going to physiotherapy, and they were telling him, dude, just be in a wheelchair. Take painkillers for the rest of your life. Just die. Yeah, just die, basically. And I was like, no. Yes, you're going to be in pain, so what? But I'm going to make you... You're going to walk. Yes, you're going to be in pain. No, it's not easy. But that's what was killing me. It's like, yes, you're fucked up. You had... they did a surgery on your back, and 3 months later, surgery on your hip. Yes, your entire body is screaming. This is not going good. This is not going to go any, good for a while. That's the way it is. But if you start to be in a wheelchair and painkillers, man, just... You're going... That's it. You're dying. And that whole, like, mental process of... You know, well, it is what it is. I was like, no, I refuse that. It's not that. I refuse that. And I was telling him, like, we have to get you back into, you're going to move all the time, 4 hours a day, and you're going to fall, and it's going to suck, and you're going to fall in front of everybody at the bus stop, and it's going to hurt, and you're going to scrape your knees, and you're going to hurt all day. But 6 months from now, you will be better.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? The idea of accepting being in a wheelchair on painkillers where you can be walking a year from now, that I don't understand. And all those physiotherapies that I was telling them, I was like, that offends me on so many levels.
As a human being.
I feel offended when I hear that.
As a living creature on earth.
As a human being talking, don't know you mean me? I was like, no, they're just killing your mind. This is death right there. If you go down that road, you will die.
Is that really what it is? Like, I was thinking, what is Julien's next big challenge? I guess it's spreading the message of strength in mind. Like, just to get the questions out of the way, yeah, no. And to fight for your strength and your
perseverance. It doesn't have to be that way. That's the thing with, like, like, just waking up. So during the Barbell Shrugged podcast, I say almost jesting, like, you know, if you're 25, you wake up in the morning and your shoulder hurts for 10 minutes, it's not normal. I was kind of making a joke, but I had so many emails of people saying, oh, man, I relate to that so
much. That's fucking super common. That's everybody in CrossFit classes. Yeah, I can hang in the morning.
And I was like, guys, this is not normal. That's actually what my biggest thing is that, I guess, normalcy. No, this is not normal. No, you're not supposed to, your shoulder is not supposed to hurt because you lifted yesterday. No, it's not. The notion of normalcy is so weird to me. And then I refuse that. I never use myself as an example, but I am 42 years old. I did carry 1,000 pounds yokes on my back. My back is fine. I am not in pain in the morning. Like, I have that freaking Korean bastard treating my foot right now, so that's another problem. But
Sun,
yeah,
he made reference to
Sun is torturing me lately. Anybody out there who knows Sun, you know what I'm talking
Sun's
about.
Sun's got fucking needle hands, man. Oh my, don't let him touch you. He'll cause you a lot of pain.
Ken of the North Star.
He fixed my wife today. He fucking magic hands, but you're gonna pay for the benefit.
For 30 minutes. He wasn't.
Yeah.
But I refuse to wake up the morning in pain. It's like, oh, you know, I'm 42. I had guys younger than me come out. You know, I have a kid. I'm 40. I have a business.
I've made that excuse.
So me too. What? I know. So what? No, I refuse that. The body is great. It's perfect. You are not supposed to be in pain in the morning. No, you're doing something wrong. But it is. You can fix that. You don't have to wake up like that. You don't have to take ibuprofen all day. No, you don't. The painkillers, they are ways to do this.
Or pre-workout.
Yes, it is. Yes.
Pre-workout every session is very bad.
It's
ibuprofen, the move, and to get your front rack position.
I'm not saying it's easy. Like that guy, by the way, the guy we're talking about, his name is Paul in the walker. He can walk without the walker, but he falls all the time. He goes back up. He does 4 hours a day, does all the exercise I told him to do. The guy is the strongest mind I've ever seen.
Keeps fighting.
He sent me a voicemail the other day that I'm going to give it to you so you can play it so people can hear. But that guy did it on his own. By the way, it wasn't me. It was him. It has nothing to do with me. All I did was to reset his mindset when it comes to stuff like that. But it wasn't me.
Yeah,
it's
teacher,
all him.
The role of the Buddha, the teacher, is only to point
the way. He walked
the
path. All I did was to show him. All I do is like walk that way. That's all I did. And he did it all on his own. The victory is his, not mine. But I'll give you the voicemail. And it's, I was like, And I told him, just thank you. As a human being, thank you. Because that's the normal way of dealing with this. Is no, fuck all of them. Refuse this. Refuse to be in pain in the morning. There are ways to do this. Mm-hmm. And I'll do my best to help to communicate the ways that I found to make this work. But I'm not the only one. I'm not smarter than anybody. I just stick with problems longer. Because I refuse to accept that as normalcy. I guess if I'm different from people, it's in, on that. It's just I refuse that normalcy. It is not normal. And I'm right. Everybody who thinks that's normal is wrong. Yeah. I'm the one who thinks correctly. The body is great. You're just fucking it up.
Yeah.
So there are ways to do this.
Yeah. What was it about being a strength coach specifically that through this craft you realized you could be your best self? Like you said, yeah, did you have this moment like you're in Brazil and said, fuck it, I'm going to do something great. Was it the moment you said, I could be a great strength coach? This could be the thing I use to change people?
I've always been obsessed with the notion of progress. Like if I can't be better today at something, it drives me insane. And so... And very early on, I found that making people better fulfilled a need. I don't know. It just gave me a peace of mind I couldn't find anywhere else. There's certain things I had many, many lives. But in one of them, when I was young, I had a brother who was my greatest influence in life, really. Mm-hmm. He's the one who, he was a smart one, actually.
I should tell you something, like he's calling his brother the smart one.
Yeah, he was. No, he was. He was the sharpest, brightest man I've to this day ever met in my life and everything. And he died over 20 years ago now, that fucker. And I miss him like it was a week ago. But not being able to help him back then is something I'll, first of all, never forgive myself for. But it gave me... I realized something is that when he died, the world lost something. Mm-hmm. The number of people he could have helped, the number of things he could have done, he couldn't because he died. And so that fueled something inside of me going like, just help. Go, just help people. It's one part because I couldn't help him, and the other part because like when he died, there's so much help that just... I'm a humanist at heart, so we can better humankind. There are ways to do this. I'm not smart enough to write like Nietzsche did. I'm not, but this I can do. Because I've always been fascinated with training and strength and everything. And I found that one area where, for whatever reason, my skill allowed me to connect to other people and show them that, at least through maybe just I understand pain better. But through that level, I can tell them you can be a better human being. Mm-hmm. You do not have to let this happen. I mean, and that so, and then from there, when I started to realize this was working, it just decided my path for me. So it was always coaching for whatever reason. Yeah. But it's just, I just want a better humankind. I mean, so when I see humans that are blocked from reaching, from moving forward for things that do not have to be, again, that I get offended as a human being and I need to do something about it.
Yeah.
Whether they want to or not, I'll go and say, no, stop doing this. You have to stop. And I got me into trouble many times. By the way, I still to this day cannot shut my mouth when I see certain things. But
I hope you never do. What?
I don't think I can. It's built in, man.
Who are some of your? Because like, what I want people to think is, people who listen to this see you as an example. Who were your mentors coming up that really influenced you in strength, like athletes or coaches? Especially what we know now, who are really ahead of their time as great people to look to, and people who can now listen to this and go study a bit to kind of educate themselves.
A book I found always interesting was Tudor Bompa. He was the grandfather of the periodization system for the Russians, and he was fairly simple in his approach and everything. Because now it's all PhD talk and everything. It's fancy words. It gets to a point when like Jesus Christ.
Is this bad as super training? I have super training here somewhere. It seems to be the record for complicated.
Can you just say the leg? Do we have to go into? Okay, there's 9 muscles in the glutes, right?
Yeah.
Can we just say the glutes? Do we have to go through the piriformis and every one of them? Jesus Christ.
Or if you say biological capacity of the organism versus in shape.
Like, yeah, okay. It's just, it gets to a point where we gotta, like, oh my
come on,
God.
Man, like, you know.
Because that's justifying your job, that's it. But
well, yeah, that's if I got a critique of strength and conditioning and fitness and strength coaches, it's like, are you here to bring what you've fought for, your experiences to the table to help people? Or are you seeing somebody get attention now? You feel like you got to be seen as just as smart as this motherfucker. I mean, come on, yeah. Man. Like, just bring something to the table. Let us learn your experiences. Bring strength and come get stronger because you shared your experience. Like, it's pretty simple.
And one of the smartest guys I actually met personally was he was a strength coach out of Cuba. he was training the Cuban Olympic wrestling Olympic team, mm-hmm. and he was the strength and conditioning coach for Baja Gracie in Rio de Janeiro. Yeah, for the MMA team. And every Monday morning, we'd go on the beach and we'd have those exercises where you do with a partner. So you put it on your back, you squat, and he squats you, and then suplex and stuff like that. So it was 9 to 12 exercises, 10 to 15 reps, three rounds, basically. Early CrossFit with a partner, basically. And that shit was so hard. I couldn't sleep on Sunday night because I knew Monday morning was coming. But it was so bad. But that was the beginning of StrongFit right there, because after 3 months of that, I was in the best shape I've ever been in. I'm 29, never been in that kind of shape.
Wow.
In my life before that, with just a touring partner once a week. It was insane. Wow. And that guy was doing it. It was designed. And then so I got to sit down with him, and then him and his broken Portuguese in mind, and he exchanged ideas and everything. And he was, but again, he was simple. He didn't try to dazzle me with words. He was like, oh, look, this is what works. This is to push this. This is to push that. And I was like, oh my God, this was like actual training based knowledge.
Yeah.
Like, and then especially me, after 3 months, I was like, this works.
This is not this really this guy works. Fought for.
Anymore. Yeah, and this isn't like, you know, 84% or do this or that. So no. You do three rounds, you do, you know, 9 to 12 exercises. Those are the good ones. That's the rep range. And then you get the guy. So this happened. And then I was like, there you go. That's what training should be. I mean, it doesn't have to be like all the periodization. And it's all good, but this is the tip of the pyramid. Periodization it's great, but like... there's so many periodization out there. They work, but that's the thing, is just find one that works. They all work. As long as you're some kind of periodization, it works.
This is the fundamental philosophical error people make, where they look at the map as if it's the thing that carries you on the road where you're going. Like, it's just a fucking plan of attack. It's just a general proposal of how things will go.
They all work.
Reasonable.
Reasonable. They all work. Yeah. All of them work. All you got to do is pick one.
Yeah.
And just make it work. Just go with it. Make it work, because guess what? The next one works just as well. It just depends how you do it. It's not what you do, it's how you do it.
Yeah.
So they all work. As long as you're on some kind of periodization, which is really a way of saying, as long as you're some kind of a plan, it's going to work. Yeah. Guess what? Welcome to life. Everything works like that. You're not going to write a book by just writing page 26 before page 12.
Yeah, you got to go, here's what I want to do.
Paragraph one, paragraph two.
Starting today, how much work do I got to do every fucking day to make that happen?
Write a page a day. You have to have a plan. So that's just that. That's what periodization is. It's just a plan moving forward. Stop getting stuck on the 84%. That's all the same. I mean, just as long as you have a plan move forward, it'll work.
Yeah.
So go back to the principle instead of methods all the time. Go back and fix the principle. Are you following the right principle? Do you understand the concept of hormesis, which is favorable response to stress? Yeah, but do you understand balance? So homeostasis, without balance, your body will push back. So you're going to go hormesis so hard, you're going to push right, your body's going to push you back toward the left, toward the middle, because that's what the body does. It wants you in the middle. Our body temperature is basically always the same. The body wants us in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
That's the problem. How do you make it go slightly forward? Not crazy forward, because it's going to push back. Yeah. So you have to understand, as a human body, as an entity, everything is connected. You can't just push and go like, yeah, I'll see what happens tomorrow. No, I can tell you what happens tomorrow. You're going to hurt tomorrow.
Yeah. Easy to predict.
Yeah, and so they look, to me, they focus on the wrong things.
Yeah.
I mean, they're so bent on this program that. It's an idea. Understand the idea. Yeah. When you read a book, read the principle. The guy is trying to tell you something. Don't read words. Read sentences, not words. I mean, you can't take things out of context. Like, the idea of context in training is completely lost. I mean, think, when you look at training, think evolution. Like, the body got us here. 300,000 years, you're not going to change it in 6 weeks, okay? That next level of periodization is not going to change your body. Yeah. I got news for you. You're going to get slightly stronger, but you're not changing the fundamentals of 300,000 years of evolution.
That's okay, the paradigm shift.
So put it in context. Context, people.
And it reminds me, you were talking about earlier, about the way you should feel after training.
Yeah.
Like, evolution wants you to get up tomorrow able to keep chasing, able to keep running. Like, how effective is it really to be participating in a training program where you are less likely to be fit the next day? Fitness in terms of the kind of fitness that really counts, your ability to survive and pass on.
Be able to actually walk because your ankle is not... Yeah,
it's a question of like a fundamental belief being caught, brought like out to everybody to see and realize that we pretty much all make this mistake in training. Like, how much in training do we gotta cut through? Like, big, obvious bullshit things. I guess this is like kind of like the only other question I've got besides another closer.
Yeah.
But like, with you, I think one thing I think of is like beliefs and getting the old beliefs out of the way. I think this is kind of what this style of training means to me. For you, can you name like one big example of like the Buddha you've met along your journey? Like the big thing you thought was always so wise and grand, that was so necessary and so fundamental. And of course, you have to do this thing. And you got to a point in your journey where you realized this is not true. And you took out your knife and fucking gutted that thing. And said, this is a lie. And you just burst through it. Can you think of a big example of a thing you're like, wow, this is complete bullshit. There's a better way.
Well, yeah, I mean, in that case, I go back to not so much a person, it was that Cuban coach, it was the training itself. What I got out of lifting a training partner for 3 months like that versus what I was getting from, not necessarily bodybuilding work, but barbells and dumbbells. I mean, I would do those three sets, and it was so bad, I couldn't wait to go for running 45 minutes, because at the end of the session, we all ran 45 minutes. I don't do running, but I couldn't wait to go running because it was so bad. And that one session a week got me more mentally and physically in 3 months than to that stage. It was like over 10 years of lifting weights and stuff like that. Got me stronger, got me fitter and everything. Once a week, I was like, dude, you've been doing it wrong.
It's like when you hear the stories of Herschel Walker doing, all he did was push-ups and hill sprints. You go, how? There's a way to make that all you need.
No, and you go like, oh, he's a freak. That doesn't work like that. But then suddenly, I was doing it, and I realized one day we were carrying, it was stupid, but we were at the farmer's market, and then I'm carrying a tray full of food. And then, so I'm on my stomach and everything, and then I realized suddenly with 25 minutes in, my back is just fine. Like, I'm not feeling it. And it's like 20 pounds of 25 minutes on my stomach, and I'm like,
You couldn't be a fucking powerlifter and do that. You could squat 1,000 pounds.
Yeah, but I couldn't do it. Yeah,
and then walk across the street holding a backpack and complain, and your feet hurt.
And everything. And suddenly I start to do jiu-jitsu, and everything is easy.
Yeah.
And I'm in shape, and I'm tired, but I can keep on going. And I'm like, I don't understand this. Worked in a way that the barbells and the dumbbells and all that stuff did not give me. That was the paradigm shift where I was like, I don't understand. I don't understand that this can give me more. Once a week of like 45 minutes lifting another human being that is awkward, not even as heavy as half the weight of what I squat.
Yeah.
And this is working better. I don't understand. It's like, no, at first you're like, no, barbell and dumbbell, this is better, the barbell. And then you do it, and after 25 years, shit. And of course, after I try still, go back to the gym and lift the barbell, I'm like, but, and then right away I felt like this is not the level of intensity wasn't there anymore. It's like, no matter how much I push the barbell, the level of intensity is not there. And then the next day my shoulder hurts. At some point I was like, dude, you got to realize this is not working.
Yeah.
And that was the start, really, where I was like, this is strange. This should not work, and yes, it does. Yeah. And talking to him was like, yeah, we all do it in Cuba. That's the way we train and everything. And Cuban wrestlers are not exactly bad. And so it was. I was
like, pretty awesome welding teams here.
Yeah, and I was like, I don't understand.
Yeah.
This is not the way to be strong. This can't be the way to be strong.
I've crossed this boundary too. Now I realize, wow, the key to strength now is not with heavy weights. Like it's that. Not in the traditional sense, not a heavy, but it's a mindfuck, not a heavy barbell necessarily.
Do you think like if you squat 400, then you have to squat 410 to be stronger?
Yeah.
No, just stay in the zone. Put weight on your back, squat, just, and over time, you'll get stronger. Almost no matter what. If you just keep lifting, you'll get stronger. Yeah. Like almost like they all have that idea, like if you do the same weight and everything, you're going to stagnate and everything. I'm like, yeah, if you just keep training, by next year, you'll be stronger.
Is it as simple as if you keep shooting free throws, you keep getting more accurate? If you keep practicing the fishing, you catch more fish. If you keep just working at your strength, it keeps you stay the capacity in the zone, that gets renewed.
Yeah, and like you get that from sharpshooters and everything. Like the more you try to aim, the less you hit the target. I mean, there's a moment where they just know they're going to hit the target. Everything is lined up, they know. And then take the shot and it's there. But the more you try to aim and to look precisely, that's usually when you fuck it up. I know that from playing pool a lot. And everything is the more you try to aim, the less you get it. There's a moment you have to flow with it. I mean, and flowing has to come also with training. It's just flow in your training. Get that balance and just do it long enough. That's the thing is people 2 weeks in and that's it. I mean, then they change everything, pedal to the metal. They do more, whatever. Just stay in the zone for 6 months and you will be so amazed how much further you can push your body than you thought. And again, the mind is what matters more.
Yeah.
It's understand what pain is and push it correctly. And the further you push your mind, the body will always follow.
Yeah.
Always.
'Tis the season. We train today. And of course, you've got some real beasts at CrossFit.
There's one or two. Yeah.
There is some there's some athletes like I told you, I go, this person is not all the way the same genetics as me. This person can do things I can't. This is complete horseshit that I've ever could think that we're on the same level.
I've seen Matty Myers. I've seen people.
Yeah, like you've that. Got some athletes now prepping. Tis the season for the games. Like one more question, I guess people might get a little excited and tittle it over. You got any big predictions or some storm fronts you see coming? What do you think is going to happen this game season? Any surprises?
Matty and Lauren. I mean, Lauren is not a surprise. Lauren finished ninth 2 years ago, but she's like. She's way more mature and she wants it. Yeah. Like the last workout, you guys will see her score. Yeah, she crushed the last workout and she was still on the world ball while she was finishing. And there's a maturity and a fire in her that I did not see last year. I mean, like she's
she's lost in the negative experience to fuel the next level. Yeah,
that
growth. Too.
And then last year she had a rough year. Like she was a lot of pressure. She's also very young. You know, like it's not always an easy position.
Lots of stake.
Yeah, and then her hip was bugging her and her shoulder. Again, we go back to, you know, the pain what it does to your mind. The hip was hurting her. The ankle was hurting her. Now I'm fixing the hip. We'll fix the ankle. So that gave her like a mind that she not necessarily had last year. And then there's Matty Myers. That's
The lats that look like a capital V.
That one is something. That's a ball of power. That one this year.
I couldn't pull the sled that she was pulling. Maybe in a couple of weeks, but I couldn't pull what she was
pulling. Matty is very, very impressive. Like you'll see. But same thing, like she had ankle pain, she had a bunch of stuff. So if I can balance those athletes out, you'll see those two will do really, really, really good things.
Yeah.
Yeah, those ones, those two, they're gonna be something.
I have no doubt, like, over the next year, we'll probably see a lot of Julien's athletes, man, doing really well.
Hopefully, at least, yeah.
Dude, we're going to come back and do another round of this.
Training. I'm here every weekend, you know that, so.
Yeah. But I'm looking forward to the journey. And just like, by the end of April, I'm looking forward to seeing these results.
Yeah, so do I.
All right, man. Thanks for joining me.
Pleasure.
Cheers. Here we go.
Cool.